even know what I did. And the only person I ever remember spanking me was Mother. And I don't know what I did, but Dad said, meet me back in the bedroom. He took me back there, and he looked at me and took off his belt, because it was always this thing. And he said, okay, when I hit this bed, you yell. And he went, bam, and I went, wow! I don't ever remember him spanking me. That's my only spanking I ever got from Daddy. Yeah, he couldn't do it.
He never hit the bed when he took me back there. I'll tell you that.
Did he spank you?
I think he might have. I don't remember.
I didn't get many spankings from him, but I do remember getting, you know,
I think I probably had three or four spankings.
When he was mad at us, he'd wiggle his belt. And sometimes he'd actually spank us. But I don't know about Abby. You know, he never really spanked me. He would take me into the bedroom like he does everybody else and jiggle his belt and make me lean over the bed and say, okay, Sadie, now you scream when I spank you. And he would take the belt and he'd hit the bed. He wouldn't hit me. Now, Mother was a different story.
Sneak out and eat them in the middle of the night. Time is probably about 2 a.m. You know, we're eating our watermelons at the YMCA, at the athletic club wall. It was a big field, and we were just in hog heaven. And all of a sudden, Miller's band pulls up. And man, I remember him saying, Glenn goes, oh, shit, you know. So we all just stick our heads in the watermelons, hoping that he didn't see us. And I'm sitting there going, man, you know, this is it. Our dad got home. And he looked at me and said, Walter, I am so mad at you, I can't talk to you right now. I'll probably kill you. He said, you go to bed and you think about what you did, and we'll talk about this in the morning. And he, you know, he could have beat me. It was the worst thing he could have done to me. Anyway, so I woke up in the morning and we talked as normal talk, and he just, you know, we wanted to make sure I didn't steal the watermelons, and I swore, you know, I didn't. That was it, but anyway.
Big Pontiac?
That big blue Pontiac.
That was a bomb. I mean, it was a giant.
We got it new. It was a good car.
Oh, I know, but it
I remember the yellow and black car a little bit, I think.
I do, too.
I remember
what
that one.
What did we call that car?
I thought it was a Beetle or some kind of Beetle somewhere or other, I thought.
Might have been. I just have a blank there.
I remember the MG. We all remember that, and going to church and laughing about the driving of the driver being on the wrong side of the car.
Gee, this is so much later. I was born, but he would come home from, he'd drive it to work.
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
He had his little hat.
Yeah. And he would come home, and we'd all the kids in the neighborhood would be out playing in the front yard, and he'd drive in the driveway, and then he'd turn left onto the sidewalk, and we'd all pile on, because the side had that nice little, you know, rent, and we'd all the kids would, yeah, we'd get on the side, and he'd drive through the front yard. Great.
And Bill went to work for Wonder Products, and Bill likes to get his friends into businesses with him. And so he called Woody one day at work and said, why don't you come out to Wonder Products? And so the next thing I knew, I got my feelings hurt because he didn't even consult me, which didn't matter anyway, but I mean, Anyway, he went to work for Wonder Products, and he wasn't worth a hoot to sell it. And so he was really sharp, you know, mechanically and every other way, and engineering. And so it just didn't work out. But they found what he was good at, and he became in charge of product development. So everybody that brought something into him, he would analyze. And he brought home, I just remember the pogo stick. I remember it was made like a horse, bridge. But I didn't remember that.
That made it very cut and dried, you know. I know he sat down and wrote out a little paper for me. And to this day, when I'm playing bridge with other people, I have to resist the impulse to say, but Woody said,
bridge in the service. Bridge and poker. He gambled in the service. Except when he played bridge. And then there was nothing nice about him. He knew all the answers and he was right. So he and John and Hal, all good players, and they would fight. They would tell verbally fight. And someone recorded them one night.
I snuck and got a tape because they were so hot.
He would get real upset when I'd do wrong, and one night we were playing bridge in a tournament, and you know, there'd be like, 12 to 15 to 16 tables, which is a lot of people, and he was really, got really peeved with me. That's the only time he would ever really say anything much. He got peeved with me because I did something wrong, and I did not think I was wrong. I remember I got up and went to the bathroom and I was crying so hard that I wouldn't go back in to finish the game. And the director came in to find me and she said, if you don't go back in, we'll break the whole game up. And I said, I can't go. So the director had to quit and finish playing the game with me. But your dad never said anything. We went on home and that was the end of that. If I was inclined way back then to, if I got my feelings hurt or something, I would sulk more, because I learned that from grandmother. And so he would just not pay any attention.
There was another time Dad got mad, and this was when I was, when Mom and I were fighting. I was like a teenager, 15, 14, something like that. And you and I really fought. And there was a time when he walked into the house and we were having one of our drill go-rounds. And I think he walked in at the moment that you had me against the wall and you were kind of hitting me with a belt or something. And I put my hands up and you thought I was going to hit you. And you exploded right at the time he walked into the house. And he walks in and goes, I don't remember his language, but what is going on here? And I was so convinced I was right and you were wrong. He said, okay, Sally, go back in the back. Andy, you stay here. And he went back and he talked to you first. And he came out, and I was just waiting to be able to prove to Dad, you know, that I was right and Mom was wrong. And he didn't take my side.
he would not have, I think I remember when you were talking about it. I don't remember exactly how he came in. But like he would not have said, you know, you're right, or treated me like the child or anything. I mean, if I had gone to the room, he wouldn't have said I was wrong or critiqued me or anything like that, no matter what he thought.
Remember Daddy flicking his false teeth out?
He sure would.
He'd go, and his partial would come out.
He liked cashews and grapefruit juice. And I remember that. And he would hide the cashews.
He tried to put it in some pipe cans, you know, tobacco cans at one time. I found those too. I found it. I knew where those raisin nuts were.
I do still drink Schlitz beer. It's my very favorite, as it was Dad's. And I remember him sneaking me a few beers when I was probably, I don't know, 18 years old or something. And we'd have a beer together. I remember that too. I'm not sure Mom knows about that one either.
She's been wide awake the whole time.
This is
that's
church.
In the choir.
This is a church.
Sitting in front
here
of everyone.
Here is
the choir.
That cross that hangs down on the back of the thing, and it's all the pokes in the background.
Memories of church and the choir, of course. I'm sure you guys talked about that. Those were unforgettable. Of Daddy in the back row and all the Polks in the choir and everybody falling asleep. It was pretty funny.
Dinners at the Polk House on Fairfield in the dining room, they were a big deal. I remember we'd have these incredible meals on Sunday afternoons. Inevitably, they would be very loud and noisy. And Dad would say, would ask everyone to be quiet. No one would pay any attention to him. Then he'd say, "I want everyone to be quiet," and would still ignore him. And at that point, he would usually stand up, put his hands on his belt and say, "I said, everyone be quiet. Where's my belt?" And he'd start shaking his belt. So he'd start shaking his belt, and we would all be quiet because we were afraid. We didn't want to get a spanking. And then one day, as we got, and he did this for years, and then one day, I remember, he pulled this thing again, and Walter called his bluff. And Walter stood up. Walter stood up and said, "Where's my belt?" and started shaking.
"Taking my belt off. You better be good."
Started grabbing his belt and shaking it like Dad. And from that point on, it became a big family joke. "Where's my belt?"
Who imitates Walter doing belt things?
Oh, Perry will go,
"Stars.
Don't make me take off my belt, Raymond."
I mean, he imitates Walter doing the belt thing, and I didn't know where that came from.
My belt off.
Dad would always go to the things I did. Like he would, when I was on the football team, he'd always go and watch the practice. Or when I was in the band, he'd always watch the band play. And I remember, I guess one of the things I remember, which I feel kind of funny about, is we'd go to church. And we'd be walking from the parking lot up to the church, and he'd put his arm around me. And I would just squirm to get out from underneath his arm. It embarrassed me. But I think he must have been really proud of his kids. And I just wasn't smart enough to appreciate it.
Oh, I remember one of my last piano recitals. And, you know, I hated those things. And I hated playing piano. And Mom would get me up every morning and make me practice. And I couldn't stand it. And I would practice every morning. And the recital was coming up. And I never did really learn my recital piece like I should have. I didn't practice it enough, and the day of the recital, Daddy had broken his leg, and he was in that huge cast. I mean, he had broken it several days before that. He and Mom came to the recital, and he was hobbling, and I think he was actually on crutches as well. And they came to the recital, and it was my turn to go on, and they were sitting there in the audience. And I came on, and I sat behind the piano, and I started my big recital piece. And I got through half of it and, of course, spaced out completely. Couldn't remember another line of it. And so I just improvised on the rest of the piece. I just simply jammed it out, you know. Well, I was having fun up there, and I got through with the recital piece, and I was feeling good about myself. My teacher was disgusted, and I think Daddy was pretty disgusted as well. And he got up on his crutches and walked out in a huff. I remember out in the parking lot, he would barely speak to me because he was so mad that I hadn't learned my recital piece. And I felt kind of bad about it, except the next time I went to a lesson, my teacher, who was real upset with me, said, "You know, I'm so mad at you for not knowing that piece, but let me just say that I probably shouldn't even tell you this, but I'm going to tell you that I've had two students who have requested that same piece." She said you couldn't give it to him because there was no such peace. So that was... Daddy loved his jazz and loved his records, and he always listened to them quite a bit when he got home from work. And on several occasions, Daddy and I would put on his records and we would dance. And I love that memory. That was pretty special. I think one of the reasons that I started singing like rock and roll and electric music is due to Dad, and that my memory of that is when I used to sit and play on the piano, and I didn't know how to play and I didn't know how to sing except in church. And I remember Janis Joplin's version of Summertime, and she screamed it out, and I loved it, and I love Janis Joplin. So I sat at the piano one day, and I wasn't even aware that anybody else was in the house, but Daddy was. And I sat down, and I played Summertime on the piano, and I was screaming, Summertime! At the top of my lungs, and I thought I was really cool, you know. I thought I was doing a great job, and that I could be a rock and roll singer. And Daddy came into the room and said, Sadie, stop it. He said, you're awful. He said, don't ever sing like that. You'll never be able to sing. So, of course, I put my mind to it to prove him wrong and continued on. And here I am today.
Idea of what day would you like to live over in your life? What day would you pick? And I'm thinking about it. One time I asked Sally what day she would like to live over, and she quickly had the answer. Do you remember it? You said it was the day that Woodie and you and all the children were out at the camp, and it was icy and cold.
That was so much fun. And Abby sat on the side and cried.
I cried the whole time.
When we hiked up that creek.
Do you remember
and,
that?
And like kind of ice skated.
Uh-huh. And got we got sticks.
Something. I mean, we didn't ice skate. We didn't have skates.
Right, just with our shoes.
Yeah. Well,
someone fell in. Sadie, big fat lady, I think, fell in.
Of course, I remember him at Hardy in the canoe, you know, with his pipe and his hat. And, fishing. Fishing with Dad, and every time I went fishing with Dad, I was the one that caught the fish, which really made him mad, because I never catch fish. The only time I ever caught a fish was when I went fishing with Daddy, and we fished with corn, and I would get hooked all the time, you know, caught in the weeds and stuff, and he'd have to get me out, and then he wouldn't catch any fish, and I would.
Dad taught me, when we went to Hardy, I got all kinds of memories of Dad and I fishing, and we would fly fish in the canoe. He'd get in the back and paddle, and I'd be in the front fly fishing just along the shore and then or the side of the river. And then we'd turn around and switch, and I'd paddle him and he'd fish.
Yeah, I never had any fish memories because he never took me because I was too noisy.
In fact, I remember one thing about Hardy is he was always late getting home right before we left because he'd always go like to Kmart or something and buy all these fishing lures. Mm-hmm. And he'd be so excited about his new Lazy Ikes.
Yeah, Lazy Ikes, I'd forgotten about.
If I didn't care more than words can say, if I didn't care, would I feel this way? If this isn't love, then why do I thrill? And what makes my head go round and round while my heart stands still?
But, sometime in that last year, he decided I could do it, and I'm going to do it. I'm going to build the house on top of the cabin. And so it began in the spring, and every weekend we would go up to Hardy, and he would work on the cabin. And sometimes Abby would be with us, but sometimes we'd go alone. He didn't want me to help. He wanted to do it himself. So I would read and cook, you know, and stuff like that. And it was like a summer of a honeymoon. It was just so fun and exciting. And there was a time when the roof, he had the roof off
before he was going to build the floor up above. And so we would sleep under the stars those weekends, you know.
If I didn't care, would it be the same? Would my every prayer begin and end with just your name? And would I be sure that this is love beyond compare? Would all this be true if I didn't care for you?
Dad was born in Columbia, Mississippi on July 30th, 1923. He got his name, Andrew Wood Polk Jr., from his father, Andrew Wood Polk Sr. Everyone called his father Pappy. His mother, Sarah Dell Polk, we called Granny. Granny and Pappy grew up in Prentice, Mississippi, and later moved to the neighboring town of Columbia when they married. Together they had three kids. The oldest was Woodie, next and 3 years younger was Martha, and the youngest, Elizabeth, was 6 years younger than Woodie.
Daddy had the store and worked 6 days a week, so we never took vacations.
Oh, so you worked all the time.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And see mother work.
In a newspaper article from around 1936, it reads, A.W. Polk, native of Prentice, came to Columbia in 1917 as a druggist, which will surprise many people, and worked here for 10 years in Barry's Pharmacy before going into business for himself. The same article talks about Granny. Not to be left out is Mrs. Polk, the owner's right-hand man in the store, and he admits that without her help he would never have made it. Mrs. Polk is an active civic worker, teaches a Sunday school class, and is active in club work.
Really? I'm making me some money. Uh-huh. I might make 50 cents or
so it was something, like that. Something you didn't mind doing?
No. I enjoyed working there. Yeah. Started out when I was 12. You know, back then, in the fall, you'd be so busy. Uh-huh. Because that's when they sell cotton and all get money, and they'd come in and buy up blue jeans and all that stuff for school children.
Right, for school. Get
and
ready.
And Daddy just really, so much of the merchandise was out.
Polk and Brimson is a mighty place to outfit the family in good, sturdy clothing from shoes on up and from underwear on out. In quality merchandise at reasonable prices, this firm is hard to beat.
Woody had to stay after the store closed and sweep the whole thing. And they used sawdust. For some reason, that's the way they swept those floors. They put this sawdust down on the floors, and then they had to push that sawdust and clean the floor. So it was hard. It wasn't like just a little sweeping. Woody had his friends, Martha had her friends, I had my friends.
No, I didn't like him when we were little. No. he loved to pick on everybody that came
and
out.
They snapped at the top and they snapped at the waist. And Woody and his friends would come along and just grab that dress and keep going. We were little, you know. Oh, she was just horrified. So she kind of quit coming for a while because she wanted to be sure Woody and his friends weren't there.
Oh, when you smile.
And he loved to make airplanes, the little model airplanes.
Mm-hmm.
And he would string them from the ceiling. He'd have them coming down and going this way.
Go in.
Airplanes
all these really pretty model airplanes that he made.
Did he want to be a pilot?
Would be hanging up. And all the boys, a lot of them, would come over and watch him, you know, and talk to him. And I'd slip in, and when they weren't there, mostly to see the planes, and just loved his room. I thought it was so nice. It was so pretty. But he loved those model airplanes.
And we had lizards. Lizards, you know, around the yard.
Mm-hmm.
The kind that make their throats come out red, you know. And he would catch those lizards and put them in the window inside his room. That was his cage.
Oh, between
the screen?
Yeah, there, that's where he kept them. One of the things I remember most of the younger days, you know, Woody had that wart.
He called it a sugar test.
Well, that's what I'm fixing to tell you.
Right.
I got that name.
Oh, okay.
We always went to Prentice, my grandmother Dale's, you know, on Sundays, not every Sunday, but to visit. And Mother had a brother, Uncle Paul, that always came when we were there. And he would just aggravate us children to death. But Woody, he'd grab Woody and tell him he was going to cut his sugar tit off his ear. And Woody would just have a fit. I mean, it was real small then. You know. And I reckon he believed he was going to do it.
He said he had, they had to have water all the time, and that the dog would kick the water over every day before his dad came.
Yeah, and then he'd fuss at Woody for not solving that problem.
He loved to have a fireworks stand out
really?
The back of the store, you know.
Oh, I didn't know that.
There was an alley behind Daddy's store.
Did you know that?
He set up his little stand back in that alley behind the store.
It was Ted Ford who lived next door. It was really lucky, just that little driveway between the two houses.
Right,
and
I remember.
They were always so close. But I remember so well a Sunday afternoon, Ted and his dad had gone fishing, and lightning struck his dad and killed him.
Oh.
And struck Ted and left a big scar across his body. And I just always, you know,
he loved to dance.
Oh. Did you?
Yeah.
Mother was so good about letting us dance in her living room all the time. I mean, there'd be 20 people at the time dancing. That's where a lot of us learned to dance. It's her living room. And so that was fun.
Pictured here is a newspaper photograph of the Who's Who winners at Columbia High School in 1940. Wood Polk, fourth from the left on the top, is identified with the title Jolliest Junior. He had many nicknames growing up in Columbia. One of these was Devereaux, given to him for his flashy dressing. After graduating high school, he left family, friends, and small town to move on to the next stage of his life.
see them, and I bet that Quonset hut wasn't as big as one, the whole thing, about the size of a fourth of this room.
Yeah.
And they had a bedroom that did hold a bed, but you had to slide around it to walk around the room. Mm-hmm. And then their living room and kitchen was tiny.
He made these little wooden balsa wood picture frames. They were like this. Made them just little picture frames, and he painted them all colors, and he decorated our walls, you know, with the little picture frames. And he had his stereo that he had bought when he was a kid up on one place. And
he would slop around that little Quonset hut in his slides, bedroom slippers, you know, where you just slip your toes in. And he said there was toothpaste all over the top of them, everything else, because they were just well used. And he said he went to class one day, and when he crossed his legs, he looked down, and there were those slipper slides on his feet. He had forgotten to change his shoes.
No, he was so proud. And then when the baby came, we had in that same bedroom, there was room for the bed, and we had room for it. We wedged a chest of drawers in there, and the bassinet was on top. That was a big deal. He was so proud of building this trailer to pull. It had to be balanced just right on the axle, you know, to pull, and he was very pleased with that. So we packed our belongings, our chest of drawers, it was the Sears that we put in, the bassinet, and headed off for Oakland, for Columbia. And, you know, he always liked to drive at night. And like Andy went the whole way, I held him in my lap with his little feet sticking up this way. And we could heat the bottle in the little cigarette lighter. It was so exciting, and he was so proud of himself because we rolled in to Granny and Pappy's house like in the middle of the night. He never liked to tell them he was coming. He wanted to always surprise them. It was really exciting to him to surprise them. And Granny would always say, well, Jenny, why don't you tell me what she wanted to know
so she could cook?
Yeah. They knew vaguely when we were coming. But we rolled into that driveway that night. Went inside, I'm sure we woke him up, and went to bed, and the next morning, Woodie went out to start the car, and he could not start it because we had used the last dime of gas to get in there, and he loved to do that. He liked to go as far as he could without filling the tank. And,
talking about some man, and I don't remember which one it was, but I was saying, he's nice, but he just, all he wants to talk about is his daughter and how beautiful she is and how smart she is and everything about his daughter.
And Woody said, I know what you mean. People like that just really got on my nerves too. Said, now it'd be different if she were really pretty like Sadie. He was our first child, and we were there with the Fibishes, and I can't remember who else, and he said the same thing, you know, baby, they got to talking about how ugly babies are when they're newborn, and he said the same thing, he said they really are ugly, how anybody could even love a little newborn baby, you know, they're not all pretty like Andy.
You were just a toddler, I guess, and you were so funny to want to cry when you cried.
They loved to make me cry.
Yeah, so, on the video, he spanks you just to get you to cry.
There's any video where I wouldn't cry. Is there any videos where I wouldn't cry? And as you got closer to Columbia, he'd get happier and happier, and he'd be singing and whistling, and he could whistle really well.
Oh, yeah, he did.
And he'd whistle to the music, and I remember his head just rocking, you know.
Uh-huh, he did. He did. And he had a big old Texas A&M ring that he was real proud of. And he would, I'd be sitting in the front seat and he'd be singing and he'd thump that ring and it hurt, but he'd be happy. He'd thump it, you know, over on me or something like that.
Place.
He loved to have just the right amount of gas. Do you remember that? He wanted to drive into that driveway on the last bit of gas. And I remember one time when we came, I guess, from Oklahoma. We drove in, got out of the car. It was always in the night because he liked to drive at night. And we went inside and went to bed, you know, and everything. And got up the next morning and Patrick was going to move the car and it wouldn't crank up. So we had to drop the gas. And he was so proud of that. Amen. We did, we ran out of gas one time. We were going from Martha's to somewhere and ran out of gas in the middle of the night, and I got mad that time. I thought, this is so ridiculous. Kids, late at night, were out of gas. I've forgotten now how he finished. See us when we lived on Klein Drive, and we put all the children to bed, and that left Sally and Neil and Woody and me. We were all up, and of course it wasn't long before Sally began to yawn. She flopped down on the floor and slept a while, but she finally had to go to sleep, and Neil had to go to sleep after a while, and they didn't go in the same room, but they went off and went to bed. And that left Woody and me, and Woody smoked, and I smoked,
and we drank coffee and we smoked and we talked about the next morning when Mike and Neil and Sally finally got up, they decided to take all the children swimming. Well, Woody and I, we were like this. We went to the river and Woody and I stretched out on the sand and just went to sleep. The poor children were out there, they could have drowned and we wouldn't have known anything about it. So finally they brought the children in and we walked home and Woody and I got some sleep. No one drowned.
And Ms. Wright needed something to teach colors with. So she came over to our house when we lived on St. Nick Road and she talked to Woody and asked him if he would make a clown, and I thought he would say no, but he got really excited and he went out in his shop and he cut the clown out of plywood and he painted it and he did it like he wanted.
States entered the war in Europe. This is the time when Dad was entering school at Texas A&M. After Dad graduated from high school, his father said, "Son, you can become partners with me in the store and we can earn a good living together." "No, Dad," said Woody. Pappy responded by saying, "Well, just go to hell." And Dad's favorite line after that was, "So I did. I went to Texas A&M. Anyone that knew Pappy couldn't imagine that he would actually say those words.
Went off to Texas A&M, and the first time he came home, I didn't even know it was Woody. He must have grown in 1 year, that freshman year. Most people grow before that, but he grew his freshman year in college, and I'm sure he grew at least a foot and maybe more. And it was just, it didn't even look like Woody. I had collected all the Glenn Miller records. I worked at Daddy's store and made $3 a day. That's what you made. And I took all that money and bought these Glenn Miller records. And one time Woody came home and he just took them all. And for some reason,
oh, no.
I still wasn't really that mad because I loved him so much. I think I thought, well, if he really wanted them, you know,
you can't.
This is the New York Stockhouse and Company little memo book. It was made for the year 1943. I'm going to read a couple of passages. Tuesday the 6th. First day in our great uncle's army. Northerners arrived today. Northerners. Not Northerners, but Northerners. Wednesday the 7th. Damn Northerners arrived today. Life is okay. First major quiz. Think I did pretty good. Got a telegram for Becky. and it proved to be an inspiration. What a woman, that Becky. Only 8 hours of classes. Got to see a show for first time since Christmas. This navigation is getting more practical every day that passes. What a hell of a note. No recreation time allowed. February 1944, Tuesday the 15th. Started celestial navigation today. Only definitions, but plenty of them. Lucky at cards, but unlucky in love. Won $20 more, but no letter from my little woman, Becky. It's Saturday the 19th. Got a wonderful letter from Becky, that sweet woman. Afraid I was in love, and it just isn't infatuation. After I got off KP. Played bridge after going to show and lost 50 cents. I loves this bridge. Saw sex hygiene again for umpteenth time. Saturday the 16th. Same demonotonous day. Monotonous day.
Monotonous.
Well, he spells it monotonous. Or okay. Monotonous.
That's how you spell monotonous.
But it's monotonous.
I don't think monotonous is a word.
Thursday the 21st. Did nothing but play bridge and poker. Lost $5.50 playing bridge. Then won $4 playing poker. Then won $1 playing 10 cents blackjack.
Before each mission, the crews participating were given a final, thorough briefing on every relevant detail of the operation. Though these raids over Germany soon became an accustomed part of the airmen's routine, each mission presented new, special problems, and each briefing held the flyers' complete attention.
The target for the day...
working at the store when they brought the telegram saying Woody was missing. And of course we all just cried and cried, and Mother just almost went to pieces, so she had to go home and I was to go home with her, which I did. And I wrote a letter to Woody that very day. I always remember this because I just knew he was okay, and I told him the telegram had come, but I knew he was fine. I just wanted him to know that we were all praying for him.
And I had never written a check on my daddy. Didn't know how. But when daddy called to tell me about Woody, he wanted to know if I wanted to come home. Of course I did. It upset me so. Ride the bus, and he said, "Well, you just write a check, get a draft back then. You get a draft check." And he said, "You just write out the check for whatever you want to write it for." He may have told me how much, and sign my name by you. And he said, "I'll go to the bank and have them to honor it." So that's what I did, and from then on, when I needed any money at school, I wrote me a check on that. I knew how to do it then.
He gave away the big secret. That's good.
Yeah.
the last journal, the one where he had been shot down. Hit in number 2 in 2 places, hit in number 3. Number 2 was burning, number 3 squirting oil. Number 1 cut off temporarily, dropped out of formation and headed for Russian lines. I gave a heading for Pex, Hungary. Hit Pex and landed with number 2 feathered. Flak holes all over plane, 1 in rudder, that I could crawl through. Russians greeted us and took us into town. Big meal with multivino. February 22nd, Thursday, sleeping in hospital.
Second day.
Cold as hell with only 1 blanket. Went into Pex with an American doctor. Drank beer and made passes at women. Heaven. Friday, third day. Soup for breakfast with Russians. With vino, slept 7 in room. Me and Burley in same bed. Eggs around 1400 hours with more vino. Multivino all day. Russian dance with multi-bound interned Czech women. Good looking women at that. Too damn much vino. Blanked out during dance. Left my woman from Bratislava on the floor alone. Into party women situation. They live in another casa in front of ours. MIA isn't bad as yet. Another dance and me with this Bratislava. Women meet. She gets indignant because we are always laughing. She thinks we are making fun of her. This is hell trying to talk to these people. Beginning to live on vino dawn to dusk. Chicken dinner with
rest from such. Even though I could write a regular volume on my experiences going through Hungary and Romania, the Army security won't permit such. We were shot down over Austria and managed to baby the plane back to the Russian lines. I knew where a small landing strip was behind the Russian lines, so we headed for it, and as you can deduct, we made it. Consequently, we had a forced landing, and not a man, including myself, was even scratched. Thank God. I am sure God was looking after each man personally after we were hit because the plane was riddled beyond recognition. After we landed, the Russians took us in hand and fed and bedded us for the night. The food was excellent, and their wine was just as fine. From there, we left by truck, about a 1903 model, and after several flats and breakdowns, we made a small town not too far from there. We were entertained in this small town by the Russians for 5 weeks before resuming our trip. These weeks were nice and pleasant. We, our crew, were the only Americans in this town, and we had the city well in hand.
Station about a quarter to four. Read a magazine and then you're in Baltimore.
We lived in a private home and they went out of their way to feed us the very best. Every night the Russian commandant had a fox trot, as he called it. Since mother luck was still in our favor, there were about 20 Czechoslovakian girls that had been going to the University of Budapest and were being sent home by the Russians. So we were entertained royally in this town. From then on out, with a few exceptions, things weren't as nice because we loaded on a boxcar, 25 to a car, and started traveling at the rate of about 80 miles a day, including stops every 10 miles. You can tell Pumpkin that her letter written after you had received the MIA letter came yesterday, and I read it several times. Thank her for writing it. Something like that makes a person feel wonderful. I must write Becky, and I am still pretty tired, so I'll close sending all my love, and for you not to worry. God is with me every time I fly. I still have to finish my mission, so I probably won't be home before July 15th or so. I will be sending a lot of money home after the 1st of April. All my love, son.
Chattanooga Choo-Choo,
won't you choo-choo me home?
Chattanooga Choo-Choo.
Woody, that was in the newspaper when he came home. Mm-hmm. You have some kind of a bond rally. And the newspaper article said something about Wood Polk had bought this big barn to start it off. Mm-hmm. You know, you can tell. Yeah.
That may be why I won the bond contest. They had a drive to see who could sell the most bonds. So I went up and down Main Street because I knew these people with Daddy having the store. Mm-hmm. And I bet Daddy bought that big bond because I won, and my prize was I was given a holiday, and I was the only one. No one else, and it was just awful because I was home and none of my friends, I couldn't call anybody, I couldn't play with anybody. It was just a terrible prize. So I went outside on the road across the street and I stood there and I'd see all my friends and they'd play with me and here I was just
Sally's not sure where exactly the old dorms were, right? But this is where the sanatorium grounds were.
Administration building was built in 1940. And then a bond was floated in 1920. Isn't that interesting? The Henry Boswell Memorial Hospital.
That's while he was in the service, he contacted TB. When they got ready to discharge him, that's when they found him.
Service. I think if I understood it correctly, that everybody who was on that plane when they were discharged had.
Pennsylvania
took a little part time. I don't know whether he was paid or not, but he was helping his friend Fred Pannell deliver groceries to the patients. And so they came by and I ordered toothpaste or something from the groceries, and that's when I met him. And he reminded me of a person in Oxford that ran a
bless you.
That ran a furniture store, and I admired that man and his wife because they seemed to be such a nice family.
Dream, and in my dream, Daddy, just a headshot of Daddy, came up to me, and I looked up. I said, "Hey, Daddy." He said, "Hey, Sadie." And then all of a sudden, his eyes weren't. I looked at his face, and his eyes weren't eyes. They were fire coming out, and it scared me to death. And I said, "Daddy, stop! You're scaring me!" And he disappeared. And that was my dream.
Just before Labor Day, Woody had to go to New York on a business trip with the tropical people, and he thought he had a bug, you know, and he was nauseated at all. So when he got home, we went on our Labor Day weekend with all our old neighborhood crowd, and that whole weekend that we were on for Labor Day, he was really nauseated, and I remember we all cooked steaks in one of the cabins one night, and Betty Dawson said, "What's Woody doing in the car?" And he was just out, just bent over, you know, the steering wheel, and I went out and he said, "I'm just sick at my stomach." And so when we got home, you know, we went and got the checkup, and that's when they said he had the lung cancer. Somebody in Memphis to get onto it, and no one was interested, and Woody wasn't interested. He didn't want to fool with it. And finally, Granny in Columbus had found a friend of his who was a general practitioner in Columbia, Mississippi. And he said, okay, he would get it. If we could get the drug, he would administer it. And I told Woody, and it involved getting him, I think, to Mexico. That's where he did. And Woody wouldn't have any part of it. And I remember Daddy said, "Sally, this is his life. You know, could you leave him alone?" And so he was dead real soon after that.
Teaching until after Dad died.
No, that's the Lord provided, because I was already teaching. I don't know what I would have done if I'd had to get out and get a job and everything. So anyway, I was going to work every day, and it was just cry all the way to work, you know. And Liz and maybe Martha and Granny came up to see Woody. And I said something about, well, I had to go to work on Monday. And Liz said, you're going to work? I mean, she was so shocked. And you know how sweet Liz was. She never interfered. And the way she said it made me think, you mean it would be okay for me not to go to work? McGee had said, he talked to us and he said, now, you're going to have, you know, there'll be some good days. And when he gets on his feet, y'all take a trip together or something like that. And I was thinking, oh, we're going to have a year or two together, you know. And then Sid's new wife had called and her first husband died with lung cancer. She said, you've got 2 months. This is all in the very beginning. And I didn't believe her. You know, I thought, why would she say something like that to me? But 2 months is exactly what we had. Your dad could still walk pretty good, and we were back in the back bathroom one day, and he was looking at himself, and he had just lost weight, you know, just thrilled him. I could remember his rear, because he always had a big rear, and he had just... skin just hanging in folds, and he said it would break my mother's heart if she could see me now. And I thought, why would he say that? You know? Troxel, just the men there were so wonderful. They'd call him every morning and ask him things about work, and they all knew he was dying. Dick Timms had a son-in-law who was a doctor, and he had already told him, this is it, it is over with. And so they called Woody every day and talked to him about work, which made him feel a part of things until finally he just couldn't think anymore. But they threw a big party, and it was for him, but I think they called it the Snyder's birthday party or something like that. And I remember getting dressed. See, I was so used to him doing everything for himself, and I remember we were trying to get him dressed. He was so weak, and I remember he was standing in the bathroom trying to shave himself. And he said, you'll have to shave me. And I said, I can't shave anybody. And so he shaved himself. It makes me feel sad in a way. But he had that razor, and he'd go like this.
Oh, gosh.
Just, you know. And he got himself shaved, and we got his clothes on. He had to be in the back. I was in the front.
seat, and he was in the back. And we just sat there. Long time, we were so happy.
It got on later, he was hallucinating really, really bad. And we were like, we'd go to bed. I was either sitting right with him all the time or I was on the phone calling about Latrell. I spent hours on the phone with him in the bed, you know. And we would go to bed at night, and he wouldn't let sheets or anything touch him. And I'd try and pull the sheet up. Don't. They're here. There were things around that was attacking him, and he had to, if he got the sheet on him some way, you know, it was just horrible. And I remember one day I woke up. I didn't wake up, and he were. But he got up and he was sitting, I don't know whether you remember, but our bed back in that bedroom was this way and the hall door was here and we had a chest of drawers and then there was a rocking chair, that rocking chair. And he got up in the rocking chair and he was just rocking. And he said, they're coming. You know, it was like people going to attack us all around. You know, I've forgotten details or something about him wanting to protect us a little bit or something like that. Just on and on and on and on. And then finally he stopped rocking and he said, it's not really real, is it? I said, no. Alone and I was so frightened that I didn't know what to do, and so it got real bad. I've forgotten what the symptoms were, but I called and they said, well, bring him into the emergency room. And I was trying to get him dressed and I couldn't get him dressed really easy. Walter walked in the door, just walked in. Walter helped me get him dressed, and Walter put him in the car, and Walter drove. My memory is I was in the front seat, and they think Daddy had to lie down. I don't know whether he
a lot. But I remember we were driving, the sun was shining, Walter was driving, going down Poplar, and I remember we passed somebody that knew us, and we waved, you know, and I don't mean that it was okay, but see, I still didn't know he was going to die. I still thought we'd get him back together. So Walter pulled into the emergency entrance. They let him out, and they got him, you know, he was helpless, got him and hauled him in and hooked him up to monitors and everything. But as I checked him in, they said, now, what's your relationship? Is this your father? He had aged so much, and that was a hurtful memory. I just really felt like that the Lord was so much in control, because I did things like that not really realizing all of y'all got there in that last time. And you and Sadie, it was because I called you and told you to come. Well, how did I know to do that?
Oh, so Sadie wasn't in Memphis either then?
No, it just happened. I was still in Memphis, and I didn't live in Paul.
Sadie, see, he got to where he couldn't eat. And so I got Sadie there before that last time when he went to the hospital. And she sat with him. She laughed with him. I remember she poked, what is it, a soft thing that you put on salads that you cut. Not an artichoke. We use them all.
An avocado.
We heard avocados were good, and she got an avocado and she chopped it up in little pieces. And I remember she was sitting beside him on the couch, poking it in, and he'd let her do it. He wouldn't let me feed him anything. And I would go to Christine Agee's to cook because he couldn't stand the smell of food and all this stuff. I remember I was, you stayed up real late. I don't know whether you stayed with us all night. I don't think you did, but I put my nightgown on and climbed on my little cot, and Daddy was on his bed, and you sat up, and I got you to read the Bible. Do you remember that at all?
You probably don't remember.
And I would call off a verse, and you would turn to it and read it, you know, and I remember talking to Woody and saying, isn't this neat? You know, our son's here, and I don't remember whether he answered me or not, but that meant a lot to me that you were there. He had been agitating, and he was seeing stuff on his feet and all kinds of stuff. And I started calling some friends. I wanted somebody, people, you know, social to be around. And I remember I called people that he worked with. You know, he just come up a while, and nobody could. And then here shows up, unexpected, Sue Webb and their friend Tony Speechley, that I didn't even really know, but he was a good friend of theirs that was at the country club. He was, what do you call it, the not social director, whoever it is that runs the country club, that was his job. So they just showed up to drop in, and they're standing there, and that's when he went into whatever it was, and not breathing, and everybody started rushing in, and you know, they put me out. Don't anybody ever put me out again anymore, but they put me out, and but Sue stayed, and then they said he was dead. Yeah, his eyes just went back and back of his head. Just like he said goodbye, and I was just, you know, saying bye-bye. But anyway, the reason I wanted you to know they put me out was because, this is going off on a tangent a little bit, a lot later I was at school, and people got to talking about when loved ones got down to where they were dying, and I said, well, when Woody got so sick, we just needed to let him go. You know, we didn't want to try and save him.
And this one teacher went up in smoke. She said, well, I don't know what I would have done if my family had thought that, because I went into arrest and they revived me, and look at me now. And I was just sick. You know, I thought, gosh, you know, I should have made them revive him. And so I talked to Sue Webb about it, and she said, honey, I stayed in there with him. Said they beat him until he bounced up. Said he was dead. So that made me feel good. But did we?
Yeah.
Eyes. Only
eyes.
Good. Yeah. Only eyes.
But you had to make a decision fairly quick. And I remember,
well, they really didn't want anything else, which I was glad of, because I don't know if I could have made the decision. After he died, I looked at his driver's license, and he had not donated his organs. He had not.
Thank you.